session of grade 8, a lesson on minerals. Today we are looking at fats, then we also look at mineral salts. Very good. So let us proceed. So fats, we can also call them as lipids. These ones, they are essential, or they are very important for proper functioning of the body. Now let us look at the biological importance of fats, or rather lipids. So they are a source of energy and heat to the body. Now, how are they a source of energy? So in terms of starvation, the fats that were stored in your body, they are broken down and then they are going to give you energy. For carbohydrates, they provide you with energy as soon as you eat them. But for fats, or rather lipids, they'll only be broken down, maybe you have not eaten or your carbohydrates are finished in the body. Very good. Then they also insulate the body. You know that most of the times we were supposed to feel cold, but because the fats are deposited in the adipose tissue under the skin, that is why most of the times we feel warm, because the fat gives us the warmth in the body. Very good. They are used for building new cells. I think the previous video we talked about proteins being part of the cells, or that they make up cells. So even the fats, they also assist to build up new cells in the body. We explained what cells are in the previous video. Very good. Now, they also assist in blood clotting. When you cut yourself, or when you have a wound, the fats are going to assist you to stop blood from oozing on that wound that you cut yourself, or maybe you injured yourself. Very good. Now, let's look at the main sources of fats. Where do these foods that contain fats come from? So we have meat, we have cheese. So you advise, especially you young people, as you are growing, to eat cheese, to eat meat, to drink milk, or to eat cake that contains milk, to eat butter, oh, milk has been repeated, to eat butter. So all these will assist you to have fats in your body. And we have already said that fats are very important because they are going to help to insulate your body. Okay, so we move on to minerals. Now, you discover that mineral salts are of different types and they also perform various functions to our bodies. We are going to start with calcium. I think you remember when we were talking about vitamin D, we say that it is quite important for the growth of bones and strong teeth. So the same also with calcium. Calcium is important for the well-being of our teeth and strong bones. Now let's look at the foods that contain calcium. So we have milk and milk products. We have fish, we have whole grain. We talked about this in the previous video. So let's look at now the importance of calcium. It is necessary for the growth of bones and teeth. For your teeth, calcium. Even when the fire is not near you, but just that heat, because your nerves are functioning properly. If your hand is the one that is near the fire, and you, maybe you are walking, you didn't realize, or it is the leg, immediately your nerves will sense that, hey, here there is dead. You withdraw your hand, or you will withdraw your leg. So when you eat foods that contain calcium, you will help yourself with the nerves functioning properly. Very good. Then also calcium is needed for the contraction of muscles. Imagine if you are not taking foods that contain calcium, you will not be able to bend, like your hand bending like this, your knee joint bending. So when you eat foods that contain calcium, they help your muscles to construct, for construction. Very good. Okay, we proceed to sodium. So this is the second mineral salt we are looking at. Let's look at the sources of food that contains sodium. seafoods and table salts. Okay, I am very sure that each one of you enjoys when there is a taste of salt in the food. There is no one who doesn't enjoy salt in the food. So it gives taste to the food. Not just that, it is quite important. We are going to look at the importance of this salt in the body. So as much as it gives us nice taste to the food, but it is also important in the body. So what's the importance of salt? It plays an important role in regulating the body fluids. Now, what do we mean? When you drink water, you drink juice, sometimes it becomes a lot in the body. So the salt is the one that regulates, or that helps to control the amount of fluids that should remain in your body. And that's why people are able to sweat, people are able to go to the loo, so that we remove the excess water in the body. So it is this salt that assists us. As you also saw that seafoods contain sodium. So in the sea, you will find that there is always salty water. So the fish that is found in the sea contains some amount of sodium. So for those people who live near the sea, such as our neighbors, Tanzania, even in Mozambique, these people, they eat food that is near the sea. So even them, they are assisted with sodium. So for us here in Zambia, we don't have a sea, but anyway, we also import a fish, tinned fish that contains sodium, so we can eat that one. Or just eat the same table salt. It will assist your body, especially where fluids are concerned. Very good. Then also it helps in the nerve transmission. We have already talked about the issue of sensitivity to our bodies or nerves impulses. Very good. Now we move on. Let's look at iron. What are the sources? This is number three now. What are the sources of food that contains iron? We have liver. Liver for nyama, that is from beef or meat, and then also, not meat, sorry, from cow, and then also liver from chicken. Yeah. Then we have leafy vegetables such as rape, eggs, meat, kidneys, and cereals. So all these, they contain iron. Now, what's the main function of iron? You will discover that iron is quite important in our bodies for us to survive. It is important for the formation of hemoglobin. We looked at hemoglobin. We said that this is the one that combines with oxygen to transport oxygen to all parts of the body. So if it is also the one that gives the color of blood, which is red. Eh? So if you don't eat foods that contain iron, you can have a problem of anemia. And we know that anemia is very dangerous, so it can also lead to death. So that's why it is important to eat foods that contain iron. Move on to potassium. Let's look at the sources of food that contains potassium. So we have vegetables and fruit juices. Now, what we have discovered as a teacher and also as a mother is that most children don't like eating vegetables. They just like eating nyama, just things for chewing. That's what they like. But you should know that if you are not eating vegetables, you're bringing a lot of trouble to your body. You can easily get sick. Okay, let's look at the importance of potassium. Aids in the nerve impulse transmission. We have already talked about this. Then it also aids in muscle contraction. So you need your muscles to move. You need your muscles to contract so that you can easily move or perform different activities. Very good. Now let's look at iodine. What are the sources of iodine? Table salt. No, like I said, salt gives taste to the food. But not just that, it is quite important because it helps or it is needed for the synthesis of the hormone thyroid, which regulates the rate of metabolic activities in your body. So we know that there are chemical reactions that take place in our bodies. Those are the ones that we are referring to as metabolic reactions. So if you don't take enough salt, then the chemical reactions in your body will become slow, and that will lead to sickness. Now, also if you are not taking salt, it can cause someone the thyroid gland. The thyroid glands are found somewhere here in the neck. And you will find that your thyroid gland swells, and then a person will have what is called goiter. I'm sure you have seen people with a big mass of flesh on their necks. It's because these people, they don't often detect table salt. Okay, so minerals are quite a lot. So those are the only ones I thought we should share together. Now let's look at the dietary needs of different people. We'll start with babies. So from birth to about 6 months, babies usually feed on breast milk. So this breast milk contains the basic nutritional elements of fats, carbohydrates, proteins, vitamins, and minerals. So in short, what we are saying is that when a baby is born, it needs to be given the mother's milk. Unless maybe the mother has some condition, then that's when you can introduce those formulas, the formula for milk which you buy in the shop. But it is encouraged that mothers should breastfeed babies very, very well and oftentimes. Very good. And then also after some time, when a baby has grown a little, after 6 months, solid soft foods are introduced to the baby's diet. And these kinds of foods can be porridge, smashed potatoes, bananas, or maybe chicken, which is also soft food. So when you introduce these kinds of food, it means that the baby has grown or is growing. Very good. Then also when the baby grows a little bit older, it requires a lot of protein foods such as meat, milk, eggs, what have you. It also requires calcium foods, the foods that contain calcium, which are needed for healthy bone formation. Then also vitamins are quite important. Vitamins and carbohydrates are needed for protecting against diseases and energy respectively. So we are saying that when a baby is given foods that contain vitamins such as fruits, this baby is going to be prevented from getting sick. And also if a child is given foods that contain carbohydrates such as cereals, such as shima, this is when the baby has grown, the baby will have energy. As you know, when someone is less than 5 years old, they are prone to be attacked by different diseases. So that's why it's important that as the babies are growing, especially older, you give them foods that contain all the nutrients that we have looked at. Okay, so let's look at the dietary needs of a sick person. So when a person is sick, the dietary needs changes depending on the nature of the disease and the test of the food he or she has. So what do we mean? For example, if a person has been found with diabetes, that person needs to adjust in his or her way of eating. So they reduce on eating foods that contain sugar. And also, for example, if a person has been found with high blood pressure, they tell these people to reduce on eating raw salt. You know, don't your mama give a show? Little cooking oil, little salt, or sometimes when it gets to the West, even no salt at all. Very good. So now, what are some of the foods that this person who is sick is supposed to eat constantly for this person to easily recover? So foods that contain proteins are needed to repair worn out body tissues. We talked about the importance of proteins in the body. So as you are getting sick, your tissues are damaged, your cells are not functioning properly. But when you eat foods that contain protein, then they are going to help you. Very good. Then also, a person who is sick requires to eat foods that contain vitamins. Why? To promote the immune system, so that the immune system can be able to fight against diseases. So when a person eats food that contains vitamins, especially fruits, this person will be able to recover quickly, because the food that this person is eating is boosting the immune system. The immune system will be able to fight against this disease a person is suffering from. Very good. Then also, foods that contain carbohydrates are needed to provide the sick person with energy. When you are sick, you become very weak. And if you don't eat foods that contain carbohydrates, you are not going to recover so fast. So you need to eat foods that contain carbohydrates for you to recover fast. You can't already. Okay, let's look at the diet that a manual worker is supposed to have. So a manual worker is a person whose work needs too much energy or uses up a lot of energy of this person. Examples of manual workers, it can include those who dig, like in the farm, pulling of things, lifting of heavy loads, maybe those who are doing heavy lifting, or those who work as electrical engineers, lifting up different machines. Very good. So a manual worker needs foods that contain a lot of carbohydrate, as we know that energy is used up. So when this manual worker eats foods that contain carbohydrate, then his body or her body is kept healthy and will be able to do his or her work. I'm sure maybe some of you whose parents drive those heavy trucks, that's also part of manual. You discover early in the morning before your dad goes for work, he eats Kansima so that he can have a lot of energy for him to do his work. Very good. Let us move on. We'll look at the dietary needs of elderly people. Now, as you know, as somebody's aging, this person doesn't move too much. Often they are just in the house, and maybe they go out, but not often times as we can compare with an adolescent. So elderly people require less carbohydrates or food that contains energy. Why? Since they are not physically active, they don't move about, so they don't need food that contain too much energy. But what kind of food do they need? So in their diet, they should include proteins. We know that proteins, they help to repair worn out body tissues. And when you are growing old, your body tissues are also dying. Then they also need minerals. They also need vitamins. So these will help to fight against diseases. As you know, when you are growing older, you even become more prone to various sicknesses. Okay, so let's look at the dietary needs or the foods that a pregnant mother is supposed to have. Now, as you know, a pregnant mother has a fetus growing in her body. So the mother requires assorted and more food to eat to provide necessary nutrients to herself and also to the fetus. Now, there are also specific foods that she needs to eat, which are very, very, very important or vital for the development of this fetus. I'm sure you have experienced pregnant mothers. They act so strange. They would want mango when it's not mango season. They would want this fruit when it's not the time for that particular fruit. So all that is because the hormones that have been produced in the body that are causing those changes, and that's why a pregnant mother will always demand for different foods. Very good. Okay, so a pregnant mother requires calcium for the development of strong bones. Now, development of strong bones, both for herself and also for the fetus. Now, if the mother lacks calcium, it will cause weak bones. Now, as you know, when a person is pregnant, their pregnancy becomes heavy, and if the bones are not strong, the woman can become weak, and this will have an impact or an effect when giving birth. So they encourage them to eat foods that contain calcium. And also for the baby, as it is, the fetus, sorry, as it is developing, it needs to have strong bones. So calcium is needed for strong bones, both for the mother and the fetus. Then the pregnant mother also requires iron, which is needed for hemoglobin formation, which helps to transport oxygen to all parts of the body, as well as to the fetus through the placenta. Now, iron is also required or is needed to produce extra red blood cells for the growth of the fetus and for the development of the placenta. We know that the placenta is a bridge, or it's the one that will help nutrients as well as oxygen to be transported from the mother to the fetus, and also the waste products such as carbon dioxide to be taken back to the mom. So the placenta is very important. Another type of food that a pregnant mother needs to have is proteins. These are required for the brain formation of the fetus. So if the mother does not require to eat foods that contain proteins, the fetus brain cannot develop properly. That's why maybe you find that a child is born and in the head there is plenty of water. A child has a big head, such kind of diseases, because the mother was lacking proteins. Okay, let's look at the dietary needs of a lactating mother. Okay, so a lactating mother is the one who is breastfeeding. So a mother who is breastfeeding actually requires to eat all the nutrients, or rather all the foods that have nutrients, should eat a balanced diet. Remember, when we're talking about a pregnant mother, we said that a baby should feed on milk, because the milk contains the carbohydrate, proteins, and all other nutrients. So if the mother is not eating a balanced diet, those nutrients will not be provided in the milk of the baby. Very good. Then she should eat more often or frequently to produce milk for her baby, and to this person the immune system to be boosted or to fight against diseases. Very good. You also need energy. So a person who is sick requires energy for him or her to recover easily. Very good. What is the function of iron to a pregnant man? Few seconds to answer. So a pregnant mother requires iron for her own sake and for the sake of the baby. So iron gives us or produces hemoglobin, which helps to transport oxygen to all parts of the body. And we know that oxygen is needed for cellular respiration in a person's body. But also the baby requires this iron for it also to breathe through the placenta, and also for the formation of the brain. Okay, so this is the end for today's lesson. That's English. This exercise marks the end of our today's lesson. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to Angie.